حملتم أهلا ونزلتم سهلا، قلوبنا مشرعة لكم وآذاننا مصغية لكم، لكم منا القرى والفضل والكرم، مدينتنا تزدان بكم وتفخر. مرحبا بكم في قلعة من قلاع العلم والتفرد والامتياز، جامعة ظفار، وهي سباقة في اهتماماتها العلمية والبحثية. وما كان مؤتمر تحديات الطاقة عنوانا يجد من الأماكن أرحب من جامعتنا سكنا، فمرحبا بكم، أنتم أهل الدار ونحن الضيوف عندكم. أيها الحضور الكريم، خير الكلام كلام الله، إنه يعلى ولا يعلى عليه، ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب، فنسقي بقلوب وبصيرة وتدبر. نستمع خاشعين إلى آيات من الذكر الحكيم يتلوها على مسامعكم القارئ حمود بن حميد الهنائي.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. الله نور السماوات والأرض، مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح، المصباح في زجاجة، الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية، يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار، نور على نور، صدق الله العظيم.
صاحب السمو، أيها الحضور الكريم، إن قيام هذا المؤتمر بمساهمة وتفاعل جاد من جامعة ظفار دعما للتواصل بين الباحثين في مختلف المؤسسات العمانية في مجال الطاقة ورفع الوعي بتحديات الطاقة ومحاولة إيجاد الحلول المقترحة لها، وإن جامعة ظفار ستدفع بعدة مشاريع بحثية في مجال الطاقة في هذا المؤتمر العلمي الهام. وفي إطار هذا الحدث نستمع وإياكم إلى كلمة رئيس الجامعة الدكتور حسن بن سعيد كشوب، فليتفضل مشكورا لإلقاء كلمته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. صاحب السمو السيد تيمور بن أسعد بن طارق آل سعيد الأمين العام المساعد للاتصالات بمجلس البحث العلمي راعي الحفل الموقر، أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، الضيوف الكرام، الأساتذة الأجلاء، حفلنا الكريم، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، وأسعد الله صباحكم بكل خير. يسعدني أن أرحب بكم في جامعة ظفار، فأهلاً وسهلاً بكم. إن جامعة ظفار تسعى ضمن رؤيتها الحالية والمستقبلية إلى دراسة القضايا والتحديات التي تهم الوطن والمواطن، وذلك من خلال أنشطة البحث العلمي وعقد المؤتمرات والندوات ودعوة الخبراء المختصين في شتى المجالات لتقديم تجاربهم وآرائهم التي يمكن أن تساعد في حل المشاكل والتحديات التي تواجه التنمية الاقتصادية والاجتماعية لدفع مسيرة التطور في هذا الوطن العزيز. الحضور الكريم، إن تواصل تزايد الطلب على الطاقة يمثل أكبر التحديات التي تواجه السلطنة في ظل النمو المتسارع لعدد السكان، فضلاً عن النمو الاقتصادي في شتى المجالات. وفي هذا الإطار فقد حددت سياسة حضرة صاحب الجلالة السلطان قابوس بن سعيد المعظم حفظه الله ورعاه رؤية عام 2020، والتي تهدف إلى إنتاج 10% من متطلبات السلطنة لموارد الطاقة المتجددة بحلول 2020 إن شاء الله، الأمر الذي يحتم علينا تطوير الخبرات العمانية في هذا المجال. ويأتي هذا المؤتمر ضمن المبادرة الفعالة لجامع الظفار وأنشطتها في مجال البحث العلمي للمساهمة في تحقيق الأهداف الاستراتيجية للدولة في مختلف المجالات بشكل عام ومجال الطاقة المتجددة على وجه الخصوص. صاحب السمو راعي الحفل الموقر، إن مسيرة أنشطة البحث العلمي بجامع الظفار تسير بخطى ثابتة نحو قاياتها بعون الله وتوفيقه وتعاون الإخوة المسؤولين بمجلس البحث العلمي وجهود الأساتذة الباحثين والطلاب، وقد تكللت الجهود بحمد الله وتوفيقه بتصنيف الجامعة في المرتبة الثالثة في مجال البحث العلمي بين كافة الجامعات العمانية وفق المعدلات التقييم ببوابة مجلس البحث Research Gate Score. وفي الختام فإنه ليسعدني أن أتقدم باسم جامعة ظفار بالشكر والتقدير إلى صاحب السمو السيد تيمور بن أسعد بن طارق آل سعيد الموقر لتفضله برعاية حفلنا واستجابته الكريمة لتلبية الدعوة لرعاية هذه الفعالية الحيوية. والشكر موصول إلى كافة الحضور على تشريفهم لهذه الفعالية، كما لا يفوتني أن أتقدم بالشكر للباحثين والمشاركين والمنظمين لفعاليات هذه الندوة وإلى كافة الجهات التي تعاونت مع الجامعة في هذا الشأن. كما أتمنى أن يخرج هذا المؤتمر بتوصيات مناء وإيجابية لتعزيز موارد الطاقة المتجددة للمساهمة في تحقيق التنمية المستدامة وتطور المنشود في هذا الوطن العزيز. حفظ الله عمان وطنا للخير والازدهار في ظل القيادة الحكيمة لحضرة مولانا صاحب الجلالة السلطان قابوس بن سعيد المعظم، حفظه الله ورعاه ومتعه بالصحة والعافية والعمر المديد، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
أيها الحضور الكريم، إن الدعوة الموجهة إلى المشاركين من مختلف المؤسسات الصناعية في مجال الطاقة بالسلطنة وخارجها لحضور فعاليات المؤتمر هدفها دعم العلاقة بين الباحثين العلميين والمؤسسات الصناعية والوقوف على التجارب البحثية العلمية المتجددة في مجال الطاقة. نستمع وإياكم الآن إلى كلمة الدكتور فتحي عباسي رئيس قسم الهندسة الكيميائية بكلية الهندسة بالجامعة، رئيس اللجنة المنظمة للمؤتمر، فليتفضل مشكورا لإلقاء كلمته.
سيد تيمور بن أسعد بن طارق آل سعيد، Your Excellency Vice Chancellor Dr. Hassan Kashour، Ladies, Gentlemen, it's a great pleasure and honor to welcome you in Salalah and the first national conference in energy challenges in Oman, ECO 2015. The aims of this conference are inspired from the guidelines of His Majesty the Sultan Qaboos bin Said as decreed in Vision 2020. This conference promotes the development, technology exchange and scientific research in conventional and renewable energy. Oman invests considerable efforts in the development of energy resources while preserving the environment. Oman is the only country in the region with a dedicated Ministry of Environment and Climate Affairs. No wonder that energy is one of the environment, is one of the research priorities in Oman. It's part of the 8 5-year plan between 2011 and 2015. Furthermore, the Research Council of Oman investigates profoundly in the development of renewable energy in the Sudan. More than 18 projects funded by TRC. In terms of conference organization, we received more than 30 papers. We select 24 by the scientific committee. We invited 3 keynote speakers from reputable national and international institutions. Professor Abdullah Al-Badi from Sultan Qaboos University, Professor Ali Kerrish from University of Western Australia, and Professor Mark Bremer from King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, Saudi Arabia. We also have an invited speaker from Research Council. This is Dr. Abdullah Saidi. Finally, I would like to welcome again and wish you a wonderful sojourn in Salalah. Enjoy your 2 days in Salalah and try to share all this knowledge and science about this energy challenges. Thank you very much.
صاحب السمو أيها الحضور الكريم، نترككم الآن مع الدكتور علي أصغر كونتراكتر عميد كلية الهندسة بجامعة ظفار لإدارة جلسة نقاشية، فليتفضل مشكورا.
Scientific meeting in Oman in the august presence of His Highness and colleagues from universities in the region. The conference is entitled Energy Challenges in Oman, and it couldn't have been more timely as discussions are going on in Paris on what needs to be done about climate change. And energy, of course, plays a central role in what is causing climate change. I would like to add that challenges actually are disguised opportunities. So one could also see this as energy opportunities in Oman, especially as Oman is blessed with so much solar insulation, and the future of renewable energy is definitely linked with solar energy. We are very fortunate to have with us today Professor Abdullah Al-Badi to give the first keynote address. He is the Dean of College of Engineering, Sultan Qaboos University. I'll just briefly introduce him to you. He's a graduate of Sultan Qaboos University, where he got his BSc in Electrical Engineering, after which he went on to do his master's and PhD at UMIST, UK. He has again come back to his alma mater to serve the institution which has created him and made him what he is. He has a large number of research publications to his credit, as well as many projects, essentially studying effects of AC interference on pipelines, renewable energy, and electrical machines. His contribution has been recognized by IEEE, the premier professional organization for electrical engineering. He's a senior member of the Society of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, and he's a consultant to the Oman Society of engineers. He's also a member of editorial boards of two international journals, and reviewer of for many international publications. So I'd like to now invite Professor Abdullah to give his keynote address. Professor Abdullah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I like to thank the organizing committee of Dhofar University for inviting me to participate in this conference. The title of my presentation will be Renewable Energy Resources in Oman, Current Status and Future Prospects. The outline of the presentation will be the status of renewable energy worldwide, electricity demand characteristics in Oman, renewable energy project in Oman, example of Sultan Qaboos University research in renewable energy, and then renewable energy TRC funded research project. If we look at the source of renewable energy, so we can have wind that can produce electrical power, solar, tidal, or wave. And the contribution of electricity generated from renewable energy increased from 0.6% in 1973 to 6% in 2013. This is if we exclude hydro. Including hydro, the total contribution is more than 25%. Why there is interest in renewable energy? Because of the pollutions, because of the depleting of the fossil fuel resources, price volatility, policies, renewable energy technology development, and the cost reduction. Now, why we have to go for renewable energy? Because of the energy security, reduced import dependency, reduction of greenhouse gas emission, prevention of biodiversity losses, improve health, job creation, rural development, and energy access. If we look at the current solar PV system capacity, in 2013, it reached around 140 gigawatt hour. Gigawatt. To give you an idea about this unit, the current capacity of the main interconnected system in Oman is around 6 gigawatt. And over here, they are producing more than 20 times of our current production from photovoltaic cell. And these are the top countries. It started with Germany, followed by China, and then the rest of the countries. If we look at the wind power worldwide capacity, it reached more than 300 gigawatt in 2013. With these are the top countries. Solar water heating, the capacity reached more than 300 gigawatt thermal. China is the leading. And for the concentrating solar thermal power, it is more than 3 gigawatt. Currently, with Spain and USA is the leading in this technology. Now, one of the main factors that prevent the widespread of renewable energy is the cost. However, there is a recent project that was done in UAE, in Dubai. They will build 200 megawatt solar power plant. And they agree that they're going to be only 22 base of your kilowatt hour for 25 years. If we compare this, the price of energy compared with the current price in Oman, this is even cheaper. In Oman, if we look at the cost of energy for the gas power station, it ranges between 25 to 30 base of your kilowatt hour. Most of the electrical energy in Oman is produced from natural gas, 97.5%. 2.5% produced from diesel. And most of our water that we are today used is coming from desalination plant, which will require also energy. The energy demand in Oman, it is shown over here, so the main sector that consumes electrical energy is the residential sector. In all system, in the main interconnected system, which is mainly the northern part of Oman, the rural area, and then the far system. This is the peak demand. So we can see that the peak demand increases from 2030 to 2014. There is an increase. Same thing also in the FAR system. And this is also the increase in the total water production. There is a significant increase. And this is the amount of the subsidy that are paid by the government. It increases from 140 million in 2013 to more than 150 million in 2014. And this is only in the water sector. In 2014, so the cost of producing electrical energy by using gas, it was 25.3 per kilowatt hour. And the amount of the subsidy that was paid by the government, it is more than 200 million. And again, this is only in the main system, which is in the northern part of Oman. In 2015, it is expected that the subsidies would increase to more than 300 million Oman riyal. And the cost of the energy is around 30 pesa per kilowatt hour. This is based on $3 for the gas price. His Majesty Sultan Qaboos said in his speech in 2008, it is also necessary to look into ways of benefiting from alternative energy resources and to seek ways of achieving food security as much as possible. This is the first, I can say that, the first project that was done in Oman, as far as I know, and it was done by Ministry of Water Resources at that time. Currently, it is Ministry of Regional Municipality and Water Resources. So they installed 10 kilowatt of wind turbine in Hala Tarwaka. This is somewhere in Tamrit. Also, a couple of PV cells were used also to power street light and also for parking meter, catholic protection, to name a few applications. This is a recent project that was done by Botanic Garden, which is under the control of the Diwan, Royal Court. So they installed 630 kilowatt in Al Khod, in Botanic Garden in Al Khod, and now they are, they say that they're going to expand the size of this power station. This is a 50 megawatt wind turbine. This one will be in Harwin. Inshallah, it is expected to operate in 2017. This is developed by rural area company with Masdar, with cooperation with the Masdar company. This is also a recent project in Al Mazyuna. Al Mazyuna was utilizing diesel fuel. But I mean, currently they are using a hybrid system, which consists of a PV and a ZDs. And this is already commissioned, and it is operating since, this year, as far as I know. This is the activity of some companies in Oman. This is the Majan company. They installed in Sohar, in their main head office in Sohar, around 37 kilowatt PV. And also they are planning to install 50 kilowatt on the rooftop of their car park. This is the activity of BDO. In 2013, they installed 7 megawatt of the solar trough steam generator for enhanced oil recovery. And since this prototype was working well, now they are working on another big project, which is around 1 gigawatt. They call it Mir'a. It is expected to start to be operated, inshallah, within a couple of years, in 2017. It is located in Amman, and it is actually the largest solar plant on our planet. This is also another activity of BDO. They install 1.2 megawatt PV system and they utilize it for their car park. So they are producing around 30% of their required energy. This is for the Nordic Oasis. They installed 6 kilowatt concentrated photovoltaic cell. And the efficiency of this kind of technology is very high compared with the normal PV. Also, there are a lot of interest by students. I mean, for example, in Sultan Qaboos University, we have a group of students. They build their own company in renewable energy. So one company is called Nathab. And some students are still in campus. They didn't graduate yet. This is another company which was also initiated by a student from Sultan Qaboos University. In 2013, the Authority of Electricity Regulation also has implemented new requirements to support the deployment of renewable energy. So now they ask RICO to include a component of 25 renewable energy technology in their annual project. Also, Public Authority for Electricity and Water has a couple of studies which are currently ongoing. General Policy for Renewable Energy Strategy, Oman Wind Atlas, and PV Rooftop Program. There is also a lot of activity done by the Research Council. The Research Council has established Renewable Energy Research Strategic Program in collaboration with the Public Authority for Electricity and Water. The strategic program covers cooling, air condition, water desalination, energy efficiency, and power generation. They have allocated 7.4 million riyal for this strategic program. I will talk now also about the activity in my university. We have a renewable energy research lab, so we install 1 kilowatt of PV, and now we have, I can say, 5 year reform data with us. We publish them in part of this data. Also, Sultan Qaboos University, I can say that we contributed in the competition that was run by the TRC, and we installed 20 kilowatt PV on the rooftop of the Eco House. We have another research project which is also funded by the TRC, which is already in the final stage. They call it a smart grid. And another research project, which is also about renewable energy, which is still ongoing. It is about power and solar cooling cogeneration. Also, Sultan Qaboos University is planning to shade 100 car park by utilizing the PV. So they're going to use 20 kilowatt of PV to shade the car park. This is also a very big study which is run by Sultan Qaboos University with Ministry of Environment and Climate Affairs. Now, if you look at the amount of radiation that received in Oman, it is really a lot. So Oman is blessed with high level of solar radiation, and as we can see that the amount of the radiation is more than 5 kilowatt-hour per meter square per day in most places in Oman, from north to south. And there is another study that was done also by Sultan Qaboos University using the GIS, and this is a summary of the study. So most of Oman area is blessed with high level of solar radiation, whether during the summer, whether during the summer time or during the winter time. And they say that if only utilize 41% of Oman area, we can produce huge amount of energy, whatever technology we are using. Even with very low efficiency PV, we can produce huge amount of energy. We can produce more than 600 times what we currently need, only from the PV cell. This is also another study that was done by Sultan Qaboos University. So we looked at seed area in Masqat. We looked at 31,000 houses. So if we utilize part of their rooftop, we can produce around 300 megawatt, which is roughly equivalent to small power station, which is even more than Manah power station. Same thing, another study was done by Sultan Qaboos University. So it say that of all electrical water heaters that we are currently using in our house is converted to solar water heater, we can save a huge amount of energy, around 200 megawatt can be saved. And we can reduce the around $115 million per year. If we look at the wind, not all part of Oman is will have a high wind speed. So it is mainly Al-Sharqiyya and the far region. They have a high wind speed, which justify building power station utilizing the wind energy. So that's why the Raiqa and Masdar, they chose Tamreed to build a 50 megawatt wind power station. Also, this is another study that was done by Sultan Qaboos University using the GIS. And this is their result. So they say that they classify the area of Oman into an unsuitable and most suitable. So you can see that the most suitable area, it is mainly in the far governorate, as well as in Al-Wusta, and maybe small part of Al-Sharqiyya. This one, of the if the height of the wind turbine is around 50, but if the height goes up, then of course the size of the area will increase. And this is the summary of the study. So they say that if the height of the wind turbine is 50 meter, then around 0.1% of Oman area will be suitable to build power, to build wind power station. As we go up, of course, the size of the land goes up also. Most of the private also university in Oman and colleges are also very active in renewable energy research. And these are only some examples. So for example, this is Nizwa College of Technology. They are working also on this research project, which is supported by the Research Council. So Harb University is also very active in renewable energy. Dhofar University also, they have, as far as I know, they have three projects, which is supported by the Research Council. Caledonian also, College of Engineering, they are also active in this area. And this table shows the summary of the research project that was supported by the TRC since 2009. So it started with Sultan Qaboos University in 2009, and in 2015, Dhofar University. So they are giving one project to Dhofar. Conclusions, secondary energy resources are currently part of the world supply mix. Oman has good solar and wind energy resources to be exploited. Electricity sector is heavily subsidized, and subsidies are increasing with the increase in demand. The largest type of load is residential, which is mainly air condition. In RICO diesel-based generation, renewable energy may be competitive with the current market condition. The first PV pilot project in RICO was constructed in Al-Mazyuna. The first wind power project, 50 megawatt, will start inshallah in 2017. Research in renewable energy are active in both public and private institutions. Recently, TRC approved the Renewable Energy Strategic Research Program. Thank you very much.
Professor Abdullah, for that panoramic view of energy situation in Oman. We have a few minutes for questions, if there are any. Can I maybe start things going? One of the points I had in mind was whether there's any work going on hybrid systems, using the PV panels for also heating of water. Mm-hmm. Is there any research on that?
Okay, I mean, actually for the hybrid system, it is already done in El Mazyoun. So there is a PV and a diesel power station over there. So it is already operating. There is another project which is done by Nizwa Technical College, and it will be inshallah in Mosira, so they will join both wind, PV, and diesel.
What I meant was solar heating.
And
PV.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Unfortunately, but of course, some people currently in Oman, they start installed at least, I mean, the solar water heater in the top roof of their houses. But I mean, currently in Oman, as far as I know, we are not generating electrical power from the, I can say, the solar thermal. Except, of course, I mean, in video. So in video, to enhance the water recovery, instead of the burn gas, they are producing steam from the sun. Yes.
So my question is regarding the storage of energy. So we could very well produce a lot of energy from solar resources or from other, including geothermal, for instance, and so forth. But what about the storage of energy? Once you produce it, you actually need a lot of effort to actually store it somewhere and use it, at a later stage and so on. Is there any research that is done that has to really address this kind of issue?
Thank you.
So you mean the storage system?
Yeah, including batteries and things like that.
Actually, in Sultan Qaboos University, we are doing simulation. We are doing simulation that so battery can be used, fuel cell can be used, and actually, inshallah, we are planning to build a second eco house. So the first eco house was supported by the TRC. But now we are planning to build another eco house, which will be supported, inshallah, by Sultan Qaboos University itself, with completely different design. And we are planning to install over there a fuel cell to store the energy. So during the night, I mean, the house will obtain its power from the fuel cell instead from the grid.
Thank you.
I guess storage is, the key problem. And batteries seem to be a problem, and I'm an electro chemist, and I really realize how little progress has been made in batteries. The other, problem with PV is that it's all silicon based, and as you know, silicon is an indirect band gap semiconductor, so efficiencies are going to be very limited. Is there any work on direct band gap semiconductors here in Oman, like gallium arsenide?
Okay, actually, the colleague of engineering was doing physics, so this is, the colleague of science, so maybe they have activity in that. But from the current, I can say, test result that we have for the last 5 years, we have really very good results. I mean, the efficiency of the 1 kilowatt that we are currently having in our lab is really promising. It's around, I can say, around 15% with the dust. Well, even without thinning the dust.
That seems to be a serious problem. I think if there are no further questions, we'll thank Professor Abdullah for an excellent presentation. Thank you. Thank all of you for your, attention. And I think we'll take a short break for tea at this stage. Thank you.
Conference. Well, welcome to you again. Our first session will be about solar energy. We have seven tables to be presented here within 2 hours according to the schedule. We welcome first Dr. Obaid Al-Saidi for his paper titled The Water Energy and Food and GCC Ring. Dr. Saidi research program, PhD in statistics from South Carolina, USA. Welcome and can start now.
First of all, I would really like to express my sincere thanks to the Far University for organizing such an important conference. And I would also like to be led, of course, by Dr. Hassan Q. And I would thank him personally also for the invitation. I'm a statistician by training, so I'm going to give you statistics. I'm not an expert on renewable energies, as Professor Abdullah is. So I will talk to you about some of the statistics that I gathered related to water, energy, and food. I will concentrate mainly on the Gulf region, but I will also have some statistics on the Arab world. Here are the contents of my presentation. I will give a brief introduction, and then I will talk about the water, energy, and food, WEF nexus for short. Then I will talk about the water, energy, food challenges facing the GCC, and I will end with concluding remarks. The population growth of the MENA region, Middle East and North Africa, is the highest in the world. It's nearly twice that of East Asia and four times that of the world's high income countries. Between 2003 and 2008, the GCC population grew by an average of 4% per year. Currently, according to some statistics, and I warn you about statistics, there's so many discrepancies in statistics, in official statistics, especially when it comes to the Gulf. But according to some of the statistics, the current annual growth rate is 2.6%. By 2020, it's expected that the GCC population would reach 53.5 million, which is a 30% increase over the level in 2000. Some projections also say that by 2030, that will increase to 65 million. Of course, this fast population growth and rapid urbanization place tremendous pressures on water, energy, food, demand and supply. Already, as it's experienced in some parts in the GCC, there are sporadic shortages of electricity, gas and water, and massive investments must be made to really meet the ever-rising needs for water, energy and food in the region. The water, energy and food nexus, it's always very difficult actually to talk about one sector of these without considering the other two. Why? Because they're interlinked and related and they affect each other. For example, to produce energy, you need water for cooling, sludge, fuel production. To produce water, you definitely need energy. And of course, to get food, you definitely need energy and water at the same time. So one of the biggest challenges facing the GCC region is actually how to effectively and efficiently manage the water, energy, and food resources. When it comes to water, the Arab region is the most scarce arid region on Earth. 70% of the land in the Arab region is dry. Of course, that's more actually in the GCC region. More than 60% of the water resources originate outside of the Arab region. The average annual rainfall is below 250 millimeters, and it's actually less than 100 millimeters in the GCC countries. Surface water is almost non-existent in some countries, and it's actually insufficient to meet the escalating needs. To make things worse, the water in the Arab countries is not used efficiently. For example, 85% of the water is used for agriculture, but only with 40% efficiency. In the GCC, depending on the country, between 67 and 93% of the groundwater is used for agriculture. Heavy usage and over-abstraction have led to water quality degradation, seawater intrusion, adverse environmental impact, and drying of shallow aquifers where they exist. All GCC countries use thousands times more water than sustainable recharge would allow. The water footprints in the GCC countries are among the highest in the world. For example, in Qatar and UAE, it is over 3,000 cubic meters per year, which is more than double the world average. UAE uses about 550 liters of water per day per person. which is 83% more than the global average as well. Seawater desalination supplies 99% of potable water in the region. In fact, GCC countries represent between, some statistics I got it, 57 to 70% of global desalination capacity in the world. As a matter of fact, 43% of all water desalination plants in the world are actually hosted in the GCC region. In 2011, Saudi Arabia was pumping 2.02 billion cubic meters, which is the largest desalination producer in the world. UAE was pumping 1.7 million cubic meters of desalinated water in the same year. It's projected that by 2050, desalination will actually account for 84% of all water needs in the region in all these sectors. In the long term, increasing salinity of the Gulf water will make desalination more difficult and more expensive as well. Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Bahrain use approximately 30% of their treated wastewater. The remaining 70% is either discharged in the Arabian Gulf or into wadis, and naturally it finds its ways to fresh groundwater. GCC countries also suffer beside the scarcity of water. They actually have a problem, or severe problem, with water storage capacity. Studies have shown that in Qatar, the water storage capacity is only for 1.23 days. That means if all desalination plants to stop operating, they will have water only for one day. UAE has storage capacity for 2 days. Of course, they realize this problem and there are measures that are taken, but this is the current statistics. The water desalination systems are almost entirely fueled by oil and gas. This is where the nexus comes into play. In the water chain, for example, energy is required at all the stages to extract water, to feed desalination plants, to produce fresh water, and also treatment and reuse. All of this are energy-intensive procedures. In fact, 70% of water costs are for power generation. In some countries, desalination consumes more than 50% of the total energy consumption. When it comes to energy, GCC countries control 40% of the world's known oil reserves and 23% of proven natural gas resources. Fast population growth resulted in escalating demand for electricity, which is typically generated by domestic gas, outstripping supply. Unless extreme measures are taken, this will result in acute shortages. Electricity demand is increasing between 7 to 8% per year on average. In the UAE, it's expected by the year 2020, natural gas will only be sufficient to meet 50% of electricity needs. In the Arab region as a whole, 67% of electricity produced depends on fossil fuels, 3% on hydroelectric plants, and only 2% on renewable resources. Still with that, 35 million Arab people live without electricity today. And energy and water waste for culture, on the other hand, has grown up around the subsidized fuel, water and energy prices in the GCC. Due to these subsidies, the rate of consumer consumption of electricity and water is extremely high in the GCC countries. For example, in Qatar and UAE, the consumption of electricity is 25% higher than the USA. According to the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, the energy subsidies for 2015 alone in UAE is $20 billion, which amounts to 2.87% of UAE GDP for 2015. In Saudi Arabia, the subsidies amount for $106.6 billion, which is 4.6% of Saudi GDP. GCC nationals actually can save about 40% of their energy bill by adopting energy-efficient products, such as what Professor Abdullah mentioned, the water heaters, for example. With continuing population growth, now I'll be talking about food, it's expected that the food demand will double in the next 50 years. The Arab countries, as isolated entities, are far from having enough water to grow sufficient or to produce sufficient basic food. They cannot do it alone unless they cooperate. As a food importing region, the GCC is vulnerable to spikes in global food commodity prices, such as the one we had in 2008. Studies have shown that more than half of the food calories consumed in the region are imported. This percentage is actually on the rise. That means half of your weight is imported, actually, if you live in the GCC countries. Food imports in the GCC countries are projected to grow to $53.1 billion by 2020. GCC countries, to try to resolve this problem, are invested in leased farm lands in Sudan, Kenya, Pakistan, North Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, Central and Southern Asia. Of course, these investments are not without dangers and risks, such as political controversies, for example, and many others. In conclusion, we really need to look at the water, energy, and food nexus approach to understand how each of these three sectors affect and relate to the other two. The water and energy agriculture policies are often actually in conflict with each other. The understanding of the nexus can be used to make and integrate management and governance across the three sectors to promote sustainable development, improve water, energy, food security issues, and reduce poverty. It will also support the transition to green economy, which aims at many other things, that resources uses, efficiency, and policy coherence. It will allow decision makers to develop strategies and investment to explore and exploit synergies and identify trade-offs among development goals related to the wealth security. There is also an urgent need for cooperation among the Arab countries to enhance coordination and investment in research and development in new technologies and renewable energy solutions. Acquiring and localizing these technologies will reduce the cost and increase the added value in the economies, and it will also have reduce the negative environmental impact. As water is scarce in the Arab region, also the scientific research and studies are scarce when it comes to the WEF nexus related to the Arab world. Research institutions and universities should be encouraged to direct their programs towards understanding of the nexus. Without such research and studies, the nexus challenges cannot be faced and solved effectively. Energy efficiency measures, improving the management of natural resources, investing in clean fuel and renewable energies and water desalination, and also educating the public about the energy and water conservation are some of the measures that should be taken. GCC countries must extract more benefits from their energy endowments by not only focusing on exporting oil and gas, but also on increasing the proportion of downstream value-added products. GCC must become a more efficient user of water and energy by changing consumer behavior, reforming subsidies, and introducing new ideas in building and transport design. As an example, just to prove that this works, when Dubai lowered the subsidies on electricity in 2011, there was a 2.2% drop in per capita electricity consumption the following year. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. And we have a few minutes for any questions if there is.
Yes, Dr. Hassan.
Yeah, Dr. You have mentioned Qatar and Dubai, each political for 1 day or 2 days without a
you have mentioned Qatar and Dubai. Each Qatar will live, they have only a reservoir for 1 day of water. And Dubai is also for 2 days. I would be happy if you can tell us how many days you will have water in Oman.
That's a very good question, but unfortunately I don't have the answer for Dr. Hassan, because statistics on Oman, official statistics, are extremely difficult to find. I redirect that question to Professor Abdullah, if he knows the answer. Dr. Ammar, you know that question? Because I cannot find the statistics.
got another question. What's the role in TRC? What's the role of TRC in the food, energy, and water access? Do you have programs that support these three different areas that makes Oman's situation better in the coming decade?
Are you asking me a question or you comment on that?
That's a question. Are we doing anything in Research Council to support these three different areas?
Until now, I don't think the Research Council has actually taken measures to look at the Nexus as a whole. But we do have projects in all of these areas. We are planning to have a research institute on food security. We are already have, as Professor Abdullah mentioned earlier, we are funding a strategic program on renewable energies. And of course, we are also planning to have a research center related to water. Actually, that's actually in the making as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Desalination of water. What is happening is that we're dumping more salt into the sea, especially the Gulf. The Gulf is, I think, dumped.
By the way, the voice is not clear.
Okay. Can you hear me now? Yeah. Can you hear me now?
A little bit. Yeah.
Okay. So what's happening by desalination, we're dumping more salt into the sea. What is that? How is that impacting the environment in the Gulf, in the Gulf Sea, basically? Where do you see the Persian Sea?
Well, I don't have the statistics on that, but actually that has actually a very severe negative impact on the environment and also on the life in the sea,
yes. On
the organisms. But unfortunately, I could not find data on how or studies that have been done to show how severely the environment is impacted by putting salt back in the sea. But it's very clear when it comes to putting it back in the groundwater that many of the aquifers in the Gulf are actually polluted because of putting salt and also because of the sewage untreated before. But now I think that's also been rectified.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, so I think we can thank again the speaker.
Thank you.
So we may move to the next paper. Is the next paper ready for presentation? Yeah? Okay, so yes? You are Mr. Al-Khari?
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In my presentation, I will talk about solarization of polluted water using solar concentrated parabolic dish collector. What I will talk about introduction, which includes the solar collectors, solar energy applications, and solarizations, and the experimental part of our study and the results of our study. And the conclusions. Solar energy is one of the most important renewable energy sources, and this solar energy can be harnessed by solar collectors, and collectors can be flat plate collector, which includes glazed and unglazed, with the heat transfer fluid, be liquid or air, and the evacuated tube, and we have the concentrating collectors, which includes the parabolic trap, and the parabolic dish, and the solar tower. And solar energy applications have different, has so many applications. The solar energy has so many applications for photothermal, which is our study. and this is, can be used for active solar heating and cooling, passive solar heating and cooling, solar thermal engines, and for solar energy vortex to produce electricity directly from the solar energy. For the photothermal process, the heat produced can be used for different applications like sterilization, which is the application of our project, and desalination, electricity and chemical reactions and other purposes. This is the solar energy principles that we can summarize. The collectors and everything about the solar energy. And we will connect between solar energy and safe drinking water. You know, as Dr. Ubaid said, that water is more recent issues today, and the water should be safe for drinking. And as we know, 75% of our body composed of water, and the safe water should be have certain limits to be considered safe, and the pollution of the water two types, which is biological pollution and chemical pollution. There are so many, so we need to do sterilization for water to be safe and healthy. Sterilizations can be divided into, there are so many methods for sterilization. We have physical sterilization, chemical sterilization, and mechanical sterilization. For the physical sterilization, we have heat, and it can be dry or moist. The dry can be used for incineration or dry oven. The moist can be used using the steam under pressure, which is used for sterilization. And also moist can be used as boiling water to have pasteurization and disinfection. And we can use radiation for doing sterilization by using ionizing and non-ionizing rays, ionizing like X-ray, cathode ray, and gamma ray, which can be used for sterilization. And we have UV light radiation that can be used for disinfection. Also, we can do sterilization by chemical methods, using materials in gaseous states or liquid materials. Gaseous states can be used for sterilization and disinfection, and liquids can be used for animate and inanimate bodies. Animate bodies for chemotherapy and antiseptics, inanimate for sterilization and disinfection. The experimental part of our study, the first element is the concentrated parabolic dish collector. We have a parabolic dish collector which is built inside Dufar University, beside the Moscow Dufar University. This parabolic dish collector has a diameter of 4.8 meter with a focal point of 1.8 meter. And the heat can be reduced in the focus of this parabolic dish collector. The temperature can reach 700 degrees Celsius. It is a huge energy that can be reduced in the focus of the solar parabolic dish collector. We will use part of this huge energy to do the solar sterilization of the polluted water. So we need a solar sterilizer, to be put in the focus of the parabolic dish collector. The solar sterilizer design, it is a steel box where there is a copper pipe inside this box in a zigzag shape and different layers. And this box has input and output, input for the, for water and out for the sterilized water. And we have also inside this solar sterilizer or steel box heat transfer fluid, which is of type Excel Therm MK1. And to control this parabolic dish collector, we have a control room to control the sterilization process. And the results of our study, we took actually polluted water from Ain Arzat spring, which is chemically safe but biologically unsafe. And we do the sterilization process where we, the temperature of the inlet water and outlet water and heat transfer fluid are controlled. Actually, we do sterilization at two temperatures, 77 degrees Celsius and 84 degrees Celsius. First of all, we took the samples from Ayn Arzat, where we have where we took the samples from three places. Place A, from the source, place B, or location B, which is 50 meters from the source, and location C, which is about 100 meters from the source. And we do the chemical analysis for this polluted water. We found that this polluted water chemically is safe. It is actually polluted biologically, not chemically. It is safe according to Oman standards, second level quality. And we do, you know, these measurements like pH, free chlorine, electrical conductivity, total dissolved solid, total hardness, carbonate hardness, manganese hardness, total alkalinity, and the anions, bicarbonate, carbonate, OH minus, and turbidity, Langlar index, also the cations, calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, and also the chloride, sulfate, nitrate, fluoride, phosphate, and silicate. We found that if we compare to the standard value, are accepted according to Oman standard for safe drinking water, second level quality. For the bacteriological analysis, for the samples, we found that these samples from Ayn Arzat spring are polluted biologically only, and you see all samples are contaminated. Total bacteria colonies too numerous to count for all locations, which should be less than 1,000. E. coli, we have from location A, 20. Location B, we have too numerous to count. Location C, 60. It should be nil. For total coliforms, we have 80. Location A, too numerous to count for location B. 100 for location C, it should be nil. And if streptococci, we didn't find this type of bacteria in the water spring. After doing the sterilization after at 77 degrees Celsius and do the chemical analysis for the sterilized sample, we find chemically that the samples becomes bitter chemically, and the quality becomes transferred from second level to first level according to Oman standard for safe drinking water. The same parameters as before. Also, at sterilization temperature 84 degrees Celsius, we have the same result. For the biological analysis after sterilization at 77 degrees Celsius, at 84 degrees Celsius, we found that the samples are free from any type of bacteria, so they are safe, biologically as a safe drinking water for drinking. Total bacteria you see, and E. coli bacteria, total coliforms, and F. streptococci, they are nil in all samples. So we found that water springs, actually from Oman, from Ayn Arzat spring, chemically safe, and it is according to second level quality, according to Oman standards for safe drinking water for locations A and B and C. This is the main, we take main parameters for all samples before sterilization and after sterilization at two sterilization temperatures. We found chemically that the values of the chemicals with the sterilizations becomes less, and this makes the water transferred from second level to to better leverage his first level according to Omani standards. This is one benefit for chemical analysis. And the other benefit is actually the biological benefit. We found that after sterilization, in general, pH does not affect strongly and it is in the normal range. Electric conductivity decreased, total dissolves decreased, and the total hardness decreased. Turbidity generally increased, but also it is in the normal range. Langer index generally increased, also it is in the normal range. The specification of water come closer to the Oman standards of quality level 1 by solar sterilizations using our system. Solar sterilizations at the 2 temperatures are good enough to kill the dangerous bacteria in the boiling water to have a safe drinking water. As a conclusion, our system is succeeded to sterilize the polluted water. The polluted water actually polluted only biologically, chemically safe. Solar sterilization makes the chemical specification of the spring water more close to the specification of the safe drinking water of first level quality according to Oman standards. And the temperatures that are used for sterilization 77 and 84 are good enough to do the solar sterilizations. The water from springs at the forage can be easily sterilized using solar energy to be a safe drinking water. Thank you for your attention.
We have time for one or two questions.
You know, dissolved salts in water by heating, okay, then cooling, it is like crystallization. The solids will precipitate after cooling. So when we did the analysis, chemical analysis, we took the cold sample after sterilization. So the extra salts will be precipitated by doing the sterilization, by heating. So the salt solid will be decreased after taking the sample at room temperature to be analyzed. This is why it is like a crystallization process. You precipitate the extra dissolved solids in the water by heating and cooling.
Okay, any other question?
The flow rate, actually we use the flow rate of the home filter pump, which is about 2.6 liter per minute. 2.6 liter per minute. Because we haven't pipes, make pipes here, the easiest way to have the filter, which the pipes, plastic pipe is already present in the market. If we have higher pipes, we cannot find these pipes inside the market.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Hassan.
Thank you very
much. I have one more question. You said it's safe for no side effect. How did you make sure? Because we know you have to use it for some years to see the side effects.
Your question is not the key.
I'm saying, I'm asking, you, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm asking about the side effect. You say it's safe, but how long have you been tested for the side effect? We know it takes years to make it safe.
How to decide it's safe or not? There is here an Oman standard for safety water, for safe drinking water. So if the specifications or the analysis of the water is according to Oman standards, so it is safe for drinking. Because this specifications always done by the municipality of, I think, the Ministry of Health or Environmental Ministry for all types of drinking water. So they take all the samples and test it. If it's according to the standards, or standards, so it's safe.
Okay.
From of your chemically and biologically.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Hassan.
Thank you.
Thank you. Parabolic flow collector presented by Dr. Saeed Rani and Dr. Saeed Rani from Dhofar University College of Engineering in mechanical engineering.
Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulullah. I would like to present my project, experimental investigation of solar parabolic trough collector, done by me and graduated student from Dhofar University. The outline of my presentation, I will talk about solar energy in Oman, motivation, conventional trough collector, new design trough collector, experimental validation and conclusion and future work. Solar energy in Oman. Oman is located in sunbelt countries. The sunbelt countries is a region where the sunshine is very high. Oman is characterized by 3,000 to 4,000 hours per year of sunshine. Oman is characterized by annual radiation rate about 2,200 kilowatt hour per year. Oman can produce up to 96 gigawatt hour of electricity. Solar thermal power plant have a good future in Oman. Okay. However, we have a problem of dust accumulation in Oman. As you see in the photo, the left side we have the red region, which is a region with a high sunshine. But when we add the layer for dust accumulation, the region will be reduced to the blue region. So the dust accumulation is a big issue for the solar energy in Oman. Conventional trough collectors. So conventional trough collector, as you know, it's open to the air, and the dust accumulation affects the performance of the trough. So when the trough is open to the air, so the dust accumulation will affect the performance of the trough and we reduce the thermal efficiency. Cleaning process. So to remove the problem of dust accumulation, we have to clean the trough. So the cleaning trough, there is a lot of methods to clean the trough. The first method is by machine, like as you see in the photo. So this machine takes a long time. High frequency, they have to clean with high frequency, and it's very expensive. Another type of cleaning, it's a new technology in Oman. A company which is called Grass Point. It's a greenhouse enclosed parabolic solar trough. As you see in the photo, we have a collector, parabolic trough collector, and are enclosed in a house made by glass. So this method is done by PDO to generate steam. So the cover glass for the solar feed is used to remove the problem of dust. So they put automatic cleaning process. This type of cleaning is highly expensive. So to build the whole field covered by a glass is very expensive, and it takes a long time for cleaning. Our new design here is to present a new design of parabolic trough collector. We propose a new design for parabolic trough collector. The trough is similar to the conventional trough, except that we add the top and sides are closed with borosilicate glass. So this is a new design. The cleaning will be very easy. We can clean with high frequency, and we can increase the efficiency of the parabolic trough. The advantage that the construction is less expensive cleaning process is not expensive. Fast cleaning process, we have a fast cleaning process. And this trap is considered as a trap of thermal energy. That means we decrease the heat losses in the trap. Experimental validation. We built two traps in Dufari University here. One is conventional trap and one is new design trap. And we compared both traps for heat losses. So we built the same size traps. They have the same size. They have the same reflective material. They have the same absorber tube and same heat transfer fluid. We use water as a heat transfer fluid. And some they have some conditions. That means we make the experiment in the same time and in the same day. The experimental result here we measure the outlet temperature, of the, both traps. So the blue curve is the outlet temperature for the new design trap, and the red curve is the outlet temperature of the conventional trap. As you see here, we enhance the heat thermal by 23% in terms of the thermal efficiency, and we have a fast heating of the heat transfer fluid. So as you see here, the outlet temperature of the blue curve is higher than the red curve. Even with the dust accumulation, we make another experiment with dust accumulation, we get a better result for the new design trap. As a conclusion, the new design of panoramic trap collector is best thermal performance, less heat losses, easy, less expensive, fast and high frequency cleaning process. For future work, we are going to change the heat transfer fluid from water to oil. So the oil can reach a temperature of more than 400 degrees C. Calculation of heat losses. We are going to make comparison between the heat losses in new design and the heat losses in conventional design, and validate experimentally the new design parametric trap collector. At the end, I would like to thank TRC for their funding of this project, and thank you very much.
Talking about dust accumulation by changing the hydrophobicity. Maybe we can talk about it.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Said, for this presentation. But I would like to ask you about the percentage of the effect of dust in your system.
Yeah.
If you have this percentage.
Yeah, for example, for the new trap, as you see in the graph. For the new trap, the temperature reached for water is 120 degrees Celsius. But when we have a dust accumulation, the temperature decreased to maybe 50%. This is because of the dust accumulation. As you see in the graph, the temperature is about 50 degrees here. So the effect of the dust accumulation can decrease the performance of the trap. And that's why we need to clean the trap frequently.
How long do you have?
Depending on the season, because for example, during the season, you have a lot of dust. So So the frequency should be high. And during, for example, the spring or the other season, the frequency can be.
I want to ask you, Dr. Saeed, about, may I ask you, about the practicality of this project? The practicality, I mean, how often we can centralize this system? How many, say, cubic meter will be produced? If this we want to present it practically in Sahara or Oman?
Yeah.
The practical side.
Okay, our system is a small trap. That's for experiment, but to make a big project with this trap, we should have a big field of solar collector. So this is just for experiment and comparison. That's it. It's a small trap.
Yes. Any questions? Thank you, Dr. Saeed. Thank you.
Paper. There's been a slight modification in the agenda, a swap between papers, and we move to a paper given by Sabah College of Technology, given by Jaya Karan and Kohotver about the individual's role in saving energy.
And good evening. My name is Khair Arwaz. I am from Sabah College of Technology, Chemical Engineering Department. I will talk today about the individual's role in saving energy. Today, what I heard from the others are ways to improve the ways to save the energy. I'm here today to talk about the individual's role in saving energy, small things that you can do to improve the energy. Our main goal today is green living for everyone, save money, and improve the environment today. Energy efficiency. Do more with less energy can benefit you, your country, and the world. The main goal here to save energy. Us as an individual level, we can improve the energy by homeowners and apartment residents alike. When we cut down the energy usage in our homes, here so we can cut down the electricity bill, save money, and also less pollution of the air and water. In Oman, practically, our main source of energy is burning of fossil fuel. But fossil fuel can have a lot of problems. What happens is when we burn fossil fuel, carbon dioxide is sent to the atmosphere with large amounts. And also coal burning produces sulfur dioxide, which leads to acid rain. One of the problems that has been produced by the carbon dioxide is greenhouse effect. What is greenhouse effect? Greenhouse effect is that gases form a layer like a glass in the atmosphere. When the sun radiations go inside the earth, this layer of glass will stop the radiation to go back from earth to the sun. This is the principle of how the greenhouse effect works. What's the problem with the greenhouse effect? That the temperature will rise, therefore it will lead to droughts. Another problem is extreme weather changes. Sometimes we can get we can have storms and hurricanes with no notice. So this problem can be caused by the carbon dioxide sent to the atmosphere. Also, the ice, the polar ice caps will melt. This thing will lead to the sea level to increase and some land to go under the sea. Also, global warming can cause some floods. So all of these burning of fossil fuel can cause a lot of problems to our environment. Another major problem are lead poisoning. It has been shown that it can affect the development of kids that their childhood is progressed near to the motorways. Also, dust and gas can lead to smog above the industrial cities. And a hole is developed in the ozone layer. This will cause the UV radiation to go inside the earth. And that will harm the people in many ways, and they will have a lot of diseases, such as skin cancer. We need to conserve our fossil fuel. We need to change the way we use electricity. We don't need to use fossil fuel to burn. We can use renewable ways to produce electricity. What are the alternative energy sources? We have a lot of alternative energy sources like wind, hydroelectric, solar, tidal, nuclear, and geothermal. Also biomass energy. The scenario here is going to be continued by Mr. Jaikran.
Good morning. This is the Oman population as of now. We have 3.5 million people. Among them, around 62.5% are in the age group of 15 to 54 years. So we have to educate this age group of people to conserve the energy. This is our motto of the paper. Also, it is mentioned every year 12% of electricity demand is increasing in Oman. So in 2050, we need a lot of electricity. So if we don't think about reducing the carbon dioxide emission, what will happen to the environment? So we have to think about this very seriously. So we have to cut the carbon dioxide emission. At the same time, we have to produce more electricity to give for everyone. So for that, we have to provide the solution. So we have to do the energy auditing, we have to use the energy efficiently, we have to use the enabled products, and we have to give energy management solution for residential buildings and industries. So through this we can save around 30% of energy. So we cannot stop the world population, or we cannot, energy demand growth also cannot be stopped. But we can change the way we use the energy and reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. So, we conducted a survey in Salalah College of Technology. We choose around 250 candidates. So we have asked a few questions to them. So one of the questions here is, how often do you close your house or office lights, ACs and fans when not in use? For that, they said 97% they said no. They don't close when they go out of the classroom. When they don't close the ACs when they go out of the office. So how much electricity will be consumed? So if your AC is 20 degrees centigrade, if you increase 1 degree, if you keep it 21 degrees centigrade, nothing will happen. But by increasing 1 degree centigrade, you can save 60 Omani riyal per annum per AC. So how many air conditioners we are using? So we have to think about this very seriously. So we have to educate our people to close the lights, fans, ACs, when it is not in use. This is very important because it is directly relating to the environment. The another question we have asked here, are you aware of the problems people around the world are facing because of our over-usage of electricity? They said no. They are asking how electricity is polluting the environment. They are not aware of these problems. So we have to educate them. For this reason only, we at Salalah College of Technology introduced the course in the diploma level, renewable energy sources. So all the students of engineering will be studying the course so that they will get some awareness about the renewable energy sources. Also, we have asked the another question, will it remind you to close the outlets if I put a poster next to each outlet in the school? They said yes, but nothing is mentioned. So it will cost very, it may not cost much. If you put a poster when it is not in use, please close. So it will save some of the electricity. Also, we asked the another question, do you think that there are enough campaigns to promote the saving and the efficient use of electricity? They said no. So nobody is bothered about the energy because it is available, we are using. But last week we visited PDO, they said only another 20 years, 25 years each well can give the crude oil. After that, what we will do? So they are producing 20,000 meter cube of crude oil per day in Marmul. along with 20,000 meter cube of crude oil, 80,000 meter cube of water is coming. See the portion of water which is also coming out along with the crude oil. So how long this crude oil will support us, we don't know. So we have to seriously think about using the renewable energy, and we have to save the energy. This is the main motto. So we have to take the energy challenge. So we have to meet energy demand as per the growing global population. We have to ensure stable and secure energy access to all nations. We have to bring electricity to everyone. 1.6 billion people are without electricity access. So we have to give electricity to everybody. And we have to stabilize the climate. This is also one of the very important things. Finally, establish the sensible legislation allowing the business to grow in an effective and socially responsible manner. So there are some conservation strategies here. So we have to understand the problem through audits. We have to size the equipment and structures appropriately. If I have a small room, 1 ton AC is sufficient, but I am putting 2 ton AC. So this is waste of money as well as the waste of energy. So we have to size the equipment and structures appropriately, and we have to share the resources. Share a lamp, save an ant. So we have to share the resources. So we should not use individually. You know, we have to share. We have to learn to share the resources. Maintain the equipment and the facilities so that less energy will be consumed. We have to increase the production. We have to pick some good sites so that people nearby will not be affected due to pollution through power plants. And we have to use some efficient architectures to save the electricity. And we have to adopt some efficient technologies too. And we have to do the insulation also for refrigerators, air conditioners, etc. So efficiency in architecture means we have to use the solar energy, we should have the daylighting, we should have the natural ventilation, and we have to have the evaporative cooling. So evaporative cooling is one of the natural way of cooling, you know. So these are the ways we can increase the efficiency of the architecture. So and some of the efficient technologies. So we can change our lighting, like using high intensity discharge lights, fluorescent lamps and LED lamps, etc. This will reduce the energy consumption, and we have to recover the heat, and we have to use the efficient equipments for refrigeration and hybrid vehicles, and we should have some automated control in lighting, heating, cooling, etc. So we have to do the insulation also for buildings, refrigeration, piping, water storage, dryers, etc. to save the energy. Most importantly, we have to understand the energy needs. Investigate the options for energy conservation and efficiency first. This is our important thing. So this is the recent photograph of Chennai, India. Due to El Nino cyclone, heavy rain. In one day, 50 centimeter rain. So see how many people are suffering. It is not only due to some country, it is the responsibility of the whole world. So we want to be safe. So if we want to be safe, we have to control the fossil fuel. This is what I mean. So finally, I would like to conclude. So do enough campaigns to save the energy as well as to save the environment. Do understand the value of energy. Do understand the pollution problems. Do follow the signboards to save the energy. So finally, I would like to say this. This plant is mint plant. This plant will give oxygen 24 hours. Even without sunlight, this plant will give oxygen for 24 hours, and it will absorb all the carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide and sulfur dioxide. It is proved by the eminent botanist. So this plant I found in the Dofa region. Lot of plants are there. So if you grow this plant in your campus, in your house, you know, it will not take much time. In 10-15 days it will grow, you will get the fresh oxygen. So this is what I would like to say. So we can think about growing these plants more so that the oxygen consumption, you know, the oxygen concentration in the air will be maintained. In air we have only 23% of oxygen and 77% nitrogen. So we have to maintain the oxygen concentration. We should not increase the carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide concentration, which will cause a lot of problems. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have time for a few questions.
Okay. For your investigation and better use of the energy needs to do a good survey. And this survey should be set with the questions. So how did you set up the questions? And did you do survey and pre-survey? Like give them survey and then give them indications and then redo the survey again.
So just we started this work actually. So we are having the plan to write proposal to some of the funding agencies, and we wanted to conduct some campaigns in the college premises and to the public also through Salala College of Technology. So that all people will aware of saving energy and the problems of over usage of electricity, etc. So we will do more survey on this.
Okay, in the last slide. Last slide, you spoke about the Tulsi plant,
yeah.
And the mill plants are two different plants. That is the not mill plants. This is my comment.
Both will give.
Second thing, the photosynthesis, the Tulsi plant can do with the presence of wind this level and the power. After the sunset, the Tulsi plant cannot do the photosynthesis.
That is the beauty of this plan actually. In 24 hours,
it's not 24 hours. So
this is in 20 hours after 24
hours,
both will be given.
Yeah, 24 hours in the presence of light. That any light, that is maybe any light, not sunlight, any light.
Yeah.
It's light.
No. They studied even in the dark room. They kept the Tulsi plant and they studied the oxygen concentration near the plant is more. That is what I put this slide. So the formation of nascent oxygen, which absorb the harmful gases like carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, even without light it is absorbing and giving the oxygen. This is the beauty. And they say 20 hours it gives oxygen and 4 hours it gives the ozone, O3. So that will replace, you know, there is a hole on the ozone, so that will replace the hole also. So if we try very seriously, surely we will have some impact on this. Already some countries started. The literature says, no, I didn't do any experiment, the literature says.
I'm not agree. Okay.
Fine, no problem, you can check. I will give you the references, you can check, no problem, sir.
Okay, any other question? Okay, so let's thank again the speaker.
Thank you very much. Our next paper will be presented by Prof. Hussain Abdulqadir. I think he will present two papers. The first one, Solar Energy at University of Najwa, Eco House, Analysis and Measurement. Professor Hussain is a professor in electronics and MSc from France, and he published more than 48 papers actually. Currently, he is acting dean for College of Engineering and Architecture. Okay, you can start.
My presentation regarding the solar energy at University of Najwa Eco House, Analysis and Measurement. This is done by our team of Eco House Construction, myself, Tor Walid, Adel Shan, and Wael Khubayr, in the College of Engineering and Architecture. The presentation outline will be started with objective of the paper, abstract and introduction, estimated energy consumption and solar energy production, CO2 emission and financial analysis, practical solar system construction and electrical implementation, and then conclusion. The main objective of this paper are to present the solar system to provide energy for University of Nezwa Eco House, demonstrate the applicability of the grid-connected solar system in the region, show the relation between the simulated and the practical measured energy result, analyze the CO2 emission reduction reaching to a green environment, and analyze the project cost effectiveness. Photovoltaic energy generating system convert, we know, especially the specialists in this field, convert the sun energy directly to electricity using state-of-the-art semiconductor material. Solar PV system vary in complexity. In general, two main categories are available. These are standalone system or off-grid system and the grid-connected system. In the grid, in the standalone system, the only source of power to home is the PV system, in which battery bank is used to store energy during the day in order to use it during the night. This type of source of energy is not suitable for the eco house design due to the environmental effect of batteries. In addition to it is more costly compared with the other alternative, because batteries should be changed nearly every 5 years, and you know the chemicals of these batteries. In a grid-connected PV system, when the amount of, we applied in our eco house, the grid-connected PV system. When the amount of solar energy generated exceed the customer load, excess of energy is exported to the grid, to the utility. Conversely, when the customer can draw needed power from the utility, when energy from the PV system is insufficient to power the building loads. Under this arrangement, the customer monthly electric bill reflects only the net amount of energy received from the electric utility. This type can be used to generate energy in the eco house. Both systems require specific components besides the PV model, not only the PV model, of course. The final cost of any PV system ultimately depend on the PV array size, which consequently the amount of the power produced by this array, inverter which is used to generate AC from the DC generated solar power, and on the other component required for the specific applications. In this paper, we cover the analysis and design of PV system for University of Nezwa Eco House. A software package, RET screen, is used to generate and estimate for the PV array size and total cost of a grid-connected PV solar system. The design considers power need, site location, local weather conditions, and equipment. Initially, the system specification were derived by estimating the load, available sunlight, and the size of the PV array and inverter needed. Then the PV specification was used to estimate the cost of the PV solar system, which include PV modules, inverter, in addition to the wires, switches, fuses, connector, and other miscellaneous parts. The design was verified by comparing the estimated design energy with the actual energy generated by the PV system, which was measured for 1 year period. The result found showed that the measurement reflect very close value used in the design of the PV system. Estimated energy consumption and solar energy production. Based on different electrical appliances used in EcoHouse and the period of its normal usage, energy consumption per month is estimated. First, the total annual consumed energy of EcoHouse is about 32 megawatt hour. This is annual consumption. This is comparable with the standard Omani house using nearly similar electrical appliances without considering any passive feature exist in EcoHouse. Because our EcoHouse, we applied some passive features which at the end reduce the energy consumption. Based on this information, a 20 kilowatt solar power will be sufficient to supply the required annual energy consumed by the EcoHouse. This is the monthly energy consumption for the EcoHouse. I think it is not clear in the screen, but starting from January until December, we see that the highest percentage in the consumption of power from May, June, July, August, September, and October. While the other month, the percentage of energy consumption is low. I think it is clear here, and during summer we use many air conditioning and cooling system. And we compare that with one of Omani house energy consumption, which this is the first one is an estimation, while this is a real consumption, which is nearly comparable with ours. The simulated annual energy production was found to be equal 38 megawatt hour when we use 80 solar panel. Each panel maximum production 250 watt capacity. It is assumed that the solar in this 250 watt capacity per panel assumed that it operate under maximum solar radiation. In other words, nearly 1 kilowatt per meter square. Based on the above study and analysis, an excess of solar energy production will be achieved, and the extra produced energy will be exported to the grid. And in this chart, we can see both the consumed energy by the EcoHouse, which is in blue and varies in month, January, February, and then May, June, July, then October, November, December, and in red, our PV energy production, our solar system production. Of course, in the summer month, the energy consumption is higher than our production. But in winter month or cold month, our production is higher than the energy consumption. In balance, we can say that the energy produced can cover the energy consumed, and we can reach what we say to zero balance energy. Zero balance energy. At the end of the year, if we calculate the bill for the EcoHouse, which will be paid to the utility, to in our region, Mazun electricity, it will be zero. If the both consumption and production are equal. Really, one advantage of the solar system is to reduce CO2 emission and reduce environmental pollution. And many presenters, of course, seeking for this advantage and for this object. The greenhouse gas emission factor is nearly 0.8 0.86 ton of CO2 per 1 megawatt hour electricity production when all types of fuels is considered in the electricity generation process. If we use all type, because there is distinguish between using oil and gas and coke and so on, but when you use all type of fuel, 1 megawatt electricity production will produce nearly 0.86 ton of CO2. Consequently, the Eco House will contribute in CO2 reduction by nearly 33 ton annually, which is equivalent to 6 car and light truck not used in the road. And this is the table from which we extract this result that nearly 33 ton of CO2 reduction can be obtained from our Eco House. Now we come to the financial analysis. The financial viability of a project depends on the technical performance, the cost, the effect of inflation, discount rate, and fuel cost, and a project life. The cost of the project include the initial cost, which cover feasibility study, development, engineering, power system, in addition to the annual cost. Based on this input data and cost of 10, we consider 10 paisa per kilowatt hour of energy produced by a traditional system. Now, all of us, for certain range of electricity consumption, it will be 10 paisa per kilowatt hour. If this increase become more, the cost of kilowatt hour will be increased and become 15 paisa and so on. So that based on this input data, a cumulative cash flow graph is given in the figure below. This graph will, this is the cash flow graph for our system. This graph reflects the cumulative net cash flow in the yearly base. In the yearly base, in this project, cumulative cash flow turns positive, means we restore our money at about 19 years. And it is the same as the equity payback period. So that we need 19 years in order to recover the initial and the cost of the system. Now, the practical implementation and construction of the solar system composed of from 80 panels. Each panel can produce maximum, as I said, 250 watt peak. Those solar panels are combined in series and parallel, 80 panels in series and parallel, in order to generate DC voltage of 616 volt and current of 32 ampere. This voltage and current is a specific input for the inverter, which is used in order to convert the DC voltage into a three-phase AC voltage, which can be connected to the grid via switching and protection circuit. This arrangement allows exporting energy to the grid during the day and importing energy from the grid during the night and heavy cloudy days. This PV system was implemented in the University of Nassau Eco House and being in operation since November 2014. The power produced by this system as a power reached the value of nearly 16 kilowatt at midday because this varies from the sunrise, then midday, until the sunset, which we produce different power. The solar energy generated by this system is, in average, 100 kilowatt per day, which result nearly in 3 megawatt hour per month. And an annual solar energy production will be 36 megawatt hour. Due to many passive features introduced in this eco house, like double wall, roof design, canopy design, a triple glazing window, and desert cooling system, we expect to reduce the energy consumption of this eco house by 40%. This has a consequence that an extra energy can be exported to the grid. The electrical circuit diagram, it will be shown in this figure, in which we have the solar system within inverter protection circuit, and this is the grid system. Our solar system is connected to the grid, and we use here really 2 meter technique. One which measures the produced power by the inverter, by the solar system, and the other measure the consumed power by the eco house. Nearly this is the last slide, in which we can see from this eco house design some sustainability fact. As I informed you that we need nearly 38 megawatt hour per year, but due to the some features, passive feature in this eco house, for example, courtyard, this reduces 6% of energy consumption. Canopy, which is like an umbrella, 3% reduction in power consumption. Window design, reduce 7%. Double wall in the construction, architecture and civil construction, 33% reduction in the cooling energy. Total reduction in CO2, this is 32.8 ton per year. We use another desert cooling system in order to cool and increase the humidity inside, because in our region, Nezo region, it is not a humid like Salalah or Muscat, and this is a competition between different universities. In our region, there is no humid weather, so that we have this system. And solar water heater also reduces the energy. Water cycling also reduces the water use. The implemented solar system is shown in the figure below, which this is our solar panels, which is arranged in the roof of the solar of the eco house in 4 arrays, each array 20 panels, which form 80 panels in total. And inclined at 22 degrees toward the south. And the final constructed eco house, this is shown in this figure, and this is the, what we say, the canopy and the different architecture, behavior, and performance of this eco house. We call it Bustan Oman. In conclusion, the advantage of using solar system in energy production is to keep the environment clean and green, and to replace the existing traditional energy sources which have limited resources. The designed eco house solar system was verified by comparing the estimated design energy with the actual energy generated by PV system, which was measured for 1 year period. Close values are obtained. The solar system of EcoHouse produces around 36 megawatt hour per year, which is comparable to the simulated solar energy production, which result in reduction of also, this is in addition, result in reduction of 32.8 ton of CO2 emission. In considering the passive feature and the performance of EcoHouse, we expect to save 40% of the required baseline consumption, which result in an extra solar energy production to be exported to the grid, and this will affect positively the equity payback period. I think I can show you only some picture. This is the double wall construction of the EcoHouse, and here also it is mentioned, presented as a double wall, which as an insulator. And here even special design in the roof, of the EcoHouse to reduce the energy consumption of this. And even, this is also a new one, we put a roof garden in the EcoHouse. Double glazing, the triple glazing window, and also a water solar heater. And this is the solar panel. Thank you very much.
Do you use a fixed system or light in the sun?
Yes.
To improve the performance? And this is the energy you produce. Do you use it inside the EcoHouse? Where do you use it?
Regarding the fixed or tracking system, of course, we used a fixed system with optimized angle. Nearly 22 angle inclination toward the south. And my next, maybe my next paper will explain why we use this. We have, we did some experimental result and experimental investigation when we vary the angle of inclination, the angle of position of the solar panel, which maximum or optimized angle we can place. We position our solar panel at fixed angle, 22 degree, toward the south. If we use tracking, it will be too expensive. Of course, it is much better to use the tracking, but you imagine if you use a tracking system for 80 panels, it will be some. And the other passive feature, we introduce this passive feature in the EcoHouse, like double wall, triple glazing, and this is a real picture from the EcoHouse.
I have a question which probably reflects my ignorance of the Omani context, but it is regarding the regulation of sending back some electricity from someone's house. If you produce a lot of electricity and you want to get rid of something because you don't want to consume all of it, so are there regulations in place that allow you to do that and to actually gain money out of selling your own energy to the grid?
Please ask me.
Okay, so my question is regarding the regulations in place
for the connection of
so that you can send your own energy that you produce from your roof and really get the money.
Yes. Thank you. As this is a new technology and new really practice in Oman to connect or to export electricity. Normally we import electricity from the company, but now it is allowed in our region. Mizun company is responsible about that, and we get the approval from them to connect our system, because it is not so easy to connect our generating system to the grid. The connection of this system with the grid, it needs certain precaution, certain specification, certain protection. This should be satisfied in order to allow to that. If we use bi-directional, and this is now permitted, to use bi-directional meter, at the end, if what you have generated, it will be reducted from what you have consumed. If the generation nearly equal to the consumed, which we seeking for that, to achieve what we say zero energy balance, you will pay nothing. If you generate more, I don't know.
Right, no.
You see, how they will pay. If you generate more, I don't know. Because this is a research. Now, we don't care about how much we will receive from the company.
Sure.
We would like to verify that our system working, and it works.
I think it's an excellent initiative, really, because on the long run, if everyone produces some energy and contributes to the grid, then everyone gains, I guess.
All right, but in, I think in Europe or in USA, this is normal, that the company will pay if you have extra energy supplied to the grid.
Yes, when I hear that in Australia, they give the money to the person or company who generate or consume less energy.
Yes. Maybe if this practice to be generalized in Oman or in our region, because alhamdulillah wa shukr, our region, and as many presenters, rich in solar energy, rich. Solar energy, this is where they will find the regulation how to pay the net.
Any question? We have Dr. Ludmilla. We have.
Now, I'd like to ask you if there is any research done by your team, for example, what is the cooling, what are the cooling demands for typical Omani residents? And what is the difference between those cooling demands and the Yeto house with those Yeto features? Because you say that you say 40%, right? So were there any study? What are the cooling demands for typical residents with the same number of occupants and the Yeto house?
For the 40% reduction in energy consumption, this is due to the passive feature included in the eco house, which is not including in the other normal or conventional houses in the region. So that if we, what we say, we are sure that when you use double glazing or triple glazing window, and use double wall, and use a certain technique in the roof design, this will isolate the house from outside, so that you need less energy to cool the house. And we, if you ask how we know this is 40%, this is, there is what we say, a computer simulation package used by one of my colleagues in the architecture department, simulate this and compare with the traditional one. So that a 40%, nearly 40% reduction in energy can be achieved.
Thank you. And my question here is, did you calculate the cooling demands of typical residents?
Cooling.
Yes.
Yeah.
We use cooling loads for typical residents and cooling loads for the Yeko house with those Yeko features, because you have 80 panels, which produce a lot of electricity.
We use the same cooling system. Yeah, same cooling system like AC.
Yeah, but you have a desert cooling system, so this operates differently or separately from air conditioning system. How they work together?
It is not. It is a split unit in our house. But we would like in the phase two, because now there is phase one and phase two, this is maybe, you see, our plan to replace this split unit to a one unit or two unit which cool the system.
So this is the future?
Yes, this is the future.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Thank you. We have another question. Yes, yes, you can. Yes.
Yeah, well, thank you for the talk. It's very informative. I'd like to ask, you would like to transfer this experience to public houses, and suppose that my house is 200 square meters. How many panels do I need to be sufficient for solar energy?
Yes. Really, this is a good question also. Our eco house surface area nearly 350 meters square. Okay, and in the next presentation, inshallah, we take a live energy consumption of one who is my student, Khamis Al-Alawi, in the next presentation. I took the real energy consumption of his house with actual habitat.
So,
8 person and a certain area, okay, and then we simulate. He need 11 kilowatt.
So
he need 44 panels.
So Professor Hussain, let's.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you very much. So let us start with the next paper with your student, with Khamis Al-Alawi. You will present the effect of solar panel position and the environmental condition on solar energy production.
The next paper is the effect of solar panel position and environmental condition on solar energy production. The first is my student, Khamis Al-Alawi, in the College of Engineering and Architecture, University of Najd. Producing electrical energy from solar energy, I will be maybe quick in this introduction, become more and more attractive solution in the field of green energy. This type of energy has no environmental effect and has a positive impact in reducing CO2 emission. This kind of solar energy can be used as a standalone source energy to power a remote site, because remote site we need standalone, no grid connected, and to the grid connected also another option. The output power of a solar panel depends directly on the amount of incident solar radiation, its position, type of the solar panel, and its efficiency, in addition to the environmental effect, which affect greatly the power production. Many researchers work on different type of renewable energy sources, investigating their performance and efficiency and the region of application, which depend on the availability of the natural resources, like rivers, wind, and sunny days. In our Arab world and in Sultanate of Oman, the more attractive and suitable renewable energy source is the solar energy, either by using solar collector, as our colleague explained, to produce steam, or a photovoltaic technique to produce electricity. In this paper, the current voltage characteristics of a specified solar panel are investigated and measured at different position, angle, and at different time during the day, showing the effect of temperature and sunny hours on the produced power from the panel. In addition, the effect of dusty, as Dr. Saeed mentioned in his presentation, there is sunny region and dusty region. In addition, the effect of dusty environment on the production of produced photovoltaic power was considered and studied. It was found that at certain panel position, the angle, position angle, the produced power will be maximum. And in this study, the angle lay between 22 and 25 degrees. A case study of providing the required energy from a solar system, a grid connected, for one of Omani houses in Al Dakhliya region is considered and simulated. RET screen software is applied to estimate the number of solar panels required to produce the electrical energy to cover the need of the house. A 44 cell solar panel are enough for indicated house. In addition, cost estimation and reduction of CO2 are also considered. I think this is the solar cell model, because now we go down to the solar cell model and to the solar cell panels. This is the model in which represent the photocurrent, the PN junction, series resistance, shunt resistance, which affect the IV characteristics, current voltage characteristics of this solar panel, and consequently of the solar cell, and consequently of the solar panel. In the practical measurement, we designed a simple mechanical setup. Is designed and used to hold the solar panel in different direction toward the sun. The range of angle variation from 0 to 90 degrees. A simple electrical setup also used in order to measure the current and voltage characteristics of this solar panel. In different day times, in different day hours from, he was tired to measure that for many days and in different months from the sunrise until sunset. He measured that and we collect the data. Of course, we leave the solar panels without cleaning, for many months, and then we come back and measure their IV characteristics in order to see the effect of dust on this solar panel. Okay, this is the normal variation of the current with the voltage for the solar panel. We see here, this is represent the short circuit current, 5 ampere, when the voltage applied to the solar panel is 0. And this represent the open circuit voltage, which is 20 volt, when the current is 0.